Welcome to the second video lecture of Culture and Literature 1.2. This lecture is created for the School of Education Department of the Rotterdam University of Applied Sciences, and my name is Ahmet Çakıyoğlu. During this lecture, you will be introduced to the diverse world of poetry. Take notes as you might need a theoretical understanding of the items discussed here during the class at the HR. So let's get started. We'll kick these lectures off with goals every time. Please assess for yourself whether or not you've achieved these goals at the end of the lectures. You can, of course, always go back in the video or watch it for a second viewing if you need to. After viewing and studying this online lecture on the introduction to poetry, you, the student, will be able to describe the difference between poetry and prose. You can also explain what is meant by rhyme, rhythm, and figurative language. You will also be able to give examples of a number of poetic devices. You explain what is characteristic of different types of poetry, and finally, you can analyze poems and you can comment on the literal, figurative, and personal meaning of a poem. During the group class in Microsoft Teams, we'll be practicing with writing poems and verses in preparation of our first weekly assignment. Here is a quick overview of what we're going to discuss. First, we'll look at what poetry is. Or at least, we'll look at some definitions of it, as poetry can be interpreted in many different ways and forms. We'll look at some different types of poetry, and then go into more detail with some so we can write our own. Now, the next topic is going to be the most fun to discuss. As you probably all know, the language of poetry is more condensed than everyday writing or speech. The words and patterns within poetry are very important. We'll look at the most important devices and study them so you can use them correctly in your own writing that you will do, obviously for the assignments, and possibly for poetry that you want to write for yourself or others to enjoy. We'll also talk about rhythm and rhyme, which will include the famous meter. Have you ever heard of iambic pentameter? Have you ever heard of Shakespeare? It will all make sense soon. I'm going to talk about this during the different types of poetry section, but we'll also summarize it in this section of the lecture, so we can see if you've been paying attention. Now, to test our progress, we are going to dive into analyzing poetry by applying everything we've learned today. Of course, I will only show an example during this lecture, but in the follow-up class, we will analyze some works together. And as always, we'll finish off with some final notes. Before we start thinking of what poetry is, let's think for a second of what poetry can do. In essence, poetry shows us the importance of words. Watch this short clip to appreciate the power of words.
Do to my sign?
I wrote the same, but in different words.
Thanks, love.
Now, the situation has not changed. The only thing that has changed is the message on the cardboard box. Although you might feel bad for the man already, assessing his disability with something that you enjoy, something that he cannot, makes it so much more personal. In this condensed message, you are emotionally triggered. And that is what poetry can do. Let's look at Emily Dickinson to understand what poetry is. She says, "If I read a book and it makes my whole body so cold, no fire can warm me, I know that is poetry. If I feel physically as if the top of my head were taken off, I know that is poetry. These are the only ways I know it. Is there any other way?" Now for a class, I want you to think about this question. How would you define poetry? Thomas Gray said, "Poetry is thoughts that breathe and words that burn." Now try and top that with your definition. Write as freely as you can in preparation of the online class a powerful definition of what poetry is for you personally. And then in class, we will look at some of your creations. Poetry is an art form in which human language is used for its aesthetic qualities in addition to or instead of its notional and semantic content. It consists largely of oral or literary works in which language is used in a manner that is felt by its user and audience to differ from ordinary prose. It may use condensed or compressed forms to convey emotion or ideas to readers or listeners' mind or ear. It may also use devices, such as assonance and repetition, to achieve musical effects. Poems frequently rely for their effect on imagery, word association, and the musical qualities of the language used. The interactive layering of all of these effects to generate meaning is what marks poetry. Now, because of its nature of emphasizing linguistic form rather than using language purely for its content, poetry is notoriously difficult to translate from one language into another. A possible exception to this might be the Hebrew Psalms, where the beauty is found more in the balance of ideas than in specific vocabulary. But in most poetry, it is the connotations and the baggage that words carry, so the weight of the words that are most important. These shades and nuances of meaning can be difficult to interpret and can cause different readers to hear a particular piece of poetry differently. While there are reasonable interpretations, there can never be a definitive interpretation. Now, this slide briefly lists some differences between poetry and prose. But instead of reading these items out loud, I'm just going to narrate on it. And if you want to, you can always pause the video and just go over these as a summary to what I'm narrating. So poetry can be differentiated most of the time from prose, which is language meant to convey meaning in a more expansive and less condensed way, frequently using more complete logical or narrative structures than poetry does. So this doesn't necessarily imply that poetry is illogical, but rather that poetry is often created from the need to escape the logical, as well as expressing feelings and other expressions in a tight, condensed manner. English romantic poet John Keats termed this escape from logic negative capability. A further complication is that prose poetry combines the characteristic of poetry with the superficial appearance of prose, such as in Robert Frost's poem, Home Burial. Other forms include narrative poetry and dramatic poetry, both of which are used to tell stories and so resemble novels and plays. However, both these forms of poetry use the specific features of verse composition to make these stories more memorable or to enhance them in some way. What is generally accepted as great poetry is debatable in many cases. Great poetry usually follows the characteristics listed above, but is also set apart by its complexity and sophistication. Great poetry generally captures images vividly and in an original, refreshing way, while weaving together an intricate combination of elements like theme tension, complex emotion, and profound reflective thought. Poetry can be intimidating, yes. It's easy to feel that it's too difficult to read and too scary to write. You might have been told that you misunderstood the poems you studied in English class in secondary school, or that the poem you wrote in which you poured out your heart was full of clichés and mistakes. If that's the case, that's a real shame. Because the world of poetry is vast and varied, and I, like many culture and literature teachers, believe with all my heart that there are poems out there you will love and types of poems you will enjoy writing. You might just need a quick introduction to various poetic forms to get you going, and not all of them are or need to be difficult or complex. You can do a quick Google search on different types of poetry and find an infinite number of possibilities. For this course, we are going to focus on 5 types that you will also be writing for your weekly assignments. If you are excited about poetry and want to learn more, just use your search engines to find out more. Now, next year, you will take a culture and literature course on Britain, and during this course, we will look in more detail to the sonnet, which is a very well-known form of poetry. But today, I will introduce the meter, and that is most used in Shakespeare's sonnets. But of course, we will not go into detail about that this year. Instead, what we will be focusing on is an acrostic poem, and there is a reason why I wrote that in all caps. We will create a haiku, a blackout poem, and a piece of free verse. Our knowledge will come together with the final assignment on the blank verse. Now, if you look at the syllabus of the course, it suggests a bio poem, but for my class I've decided to go with blank verse as it leads you more into what is to come in future courses, at least I think. So anyway, let's start with the acrostic. A poem in which all the first letters of every line combined form a word when read vertically is called an acrostic poem. And acrostic poems have been around for centuries. The earliest record of an acrostic use is in the prophecies of the Erythraean Sibyl, prophetesses who were believed to have predicted the Trojan War and other historical events. The prophecies were written on leaves, and then the leaves were positioned so that the first letter of each leaf created a word. An acrostic poem was also found at Pompeii during an archaeological excavation. Since the messages in acrostics are usually visible only when it is understood when each line of poetry begins and ends, it is believed that, unlike other poetic forms, acrostic poetry was first written rather than passed down orally. Acrostic poems can be found in many different types of literature. There are at least 12 clear examples of acrostics in the Old Testament. Shakespeare is said to have used acrostics to hide messages from Christopher Marlowe. And Edgar Allan Poe wrote a poem titled A Valentine in which he spelled out the name Francis Sargent Osgood. Lewis Carroll used an acrostic poem at the end of his book Through the Looking Glass to highlight the name of Alice Pleasance Little, on whom Alice in Wonderland is based. Some writers would decorate the first letter of each line to stand out, while others, especially Renaissance writers, would use the poems as hidden messages. If you look at the acrostic I made just for you, you can read, a very simple sentence can be the beginning of really amazing things, or maybe something very small. So start writing and taste that wonderful taste of poetry. It will take you places you could never dream of imagining before. As you can see here, I've taken some liberties with sentence structure. Not every line is a full sentence, and some lines actually start with a word from the previous sentence. In poetry, you can take liberties and play with the language, something you could probably never do in essay writing or on tests. Poetry is all about choices you make as a writer, or personal interpretations you have as a reader, even in something as simple as an acrostic poem. Try writing an acrostic poem with the letters of your first name and bring it to class to show off your skills. This will be a lead-in to the weekly assignment we'll do. Now, a haiku is a very short poem. It actually only consists of 3 lines of writing. The lines consist of 5, 7, and again 5 syllables simultaneously. A haiku often uses sensory language. And what that means is, in writing, sensory language is a way for a writer to help the reader see or connect with an image, a description, an action, or a scene. Sensory language is the language that connects to the 5 senses, so sight, sound, smell, taste, and touch. It does this to create an image or description. A haiku is often inspired by nature, or a moment of beauty, or a poignant experience. In a few slides, we're going to look at some poetic devices, including similes and metaphors. These usually have a large role in poetry, but in the haiku, writers often avoid them. Instead, a haiku is meant to be simple and easy to understand. They're created to convey a very short message that could be read in one breath. Now, a haiku should include a kigo, which translates to a season word. This word indicates what season of the year the haiku is set. Let's look at an example. Clouds appear and bring to men a chance to rest from looking at the moon. The kigo in this haiku is the word clouds. The clouds indicate a rainy season. As you can see, the structure of this haiku follows the 5-7-5 syllable rule. Now, you do not yet have to write your own haiku, but instead try to think of what this short poem could mean. But again, keep in mind that a haiku is not supposed to be very difficult to understand. You can either pause the video right now or memorize it in the next 2 seconds. Moving on to a blackout poem. And a blackout poem can be created using any kind of text, but it's usually a newspaper article. All you need is a good marker and you can create something new by blacking out words you don't want to use in your poem. You can be as creative as you want, as a blackout poem does not have any other guidelines regarding rhythm and rhyme. Look at the article here. You don't have to read it, but just quickly glance at what the topic is. Now I'll show you the blackout poem I created from it. Future generations protect Earth and all of us. So as you can see, I put a lot of faith in you all. I didn't use any word from the Trump paragraph. There is no real reason behind that, except that I couldn't find anything intelligent to work with. You can take from that what you want. So as you can see, creating a blackout poem really isn't that hard, and it's a very fun activity to do with your secondary school pupils as well. You can get them interested in language by using poetry, and you don't even have to call it poetry. They don't have to write anything down themselves, but they still work with the language. Doing this in class, you can even give every student the same article, and you'll be amazed with the many different options they'll present. Poetry rules. Free verse is a literary device that can be defined as poetry that is free from limitations of regular meter or rhythm, and they do not rhyme with fixed forms. Such poems are without rhythm and rhyme schemes, do not follow regular rhyme scheme rules, yet still provide artistic expression. In this way, the poet can give his own shape to a poem however he or she desires. However, it still allows poets to use alliteration, rhyme, cadences, and rhythms to get the effects that they consider are suitable for the piece. This piece of free verse on the left is written by Carl Sandburg, and it reads, "The fog comes on, little cat feet. It sits looking over harbor and city on silent haunches and then moves on." You might be wondering, if free verse doesn't have a rhyme or a meter, how is it different from prose or ordinary written or spoken word? Now, to begin with, free verse does follow conventional poetry in that it has intentional line breaks. The lines, which are often irregular and very short, at the very least give free verse poems the look of poetry. As you can see in Fog, the line breaks where the reader needs to pause, enhancing the overall reading of the verse. These poems also rely on devices that set them apart from everyday language, including parallelisms, using similar grammatical constructions and repetition of sounds and images. So while free verse may use some of the same conversational cadences found in prose, it is poetry because of its line breaks and its use of other poetic devices. Now, free verse should not be confused with blank verse. Blank verse is a literary device defined as an unrhyming verse written in iambic pentameter. Now don't worry, I haven't explained what that is yet, so if you don't know what iambic pentameter is, don't feel stressed out. In poetry and prose, an iambic pentameter means there is a consistent meter with 10 syllables in each line. One of Shakespeare's most famous sonnets, Sonnet 18, is called "Shall I Compare Thee to a Summer's Day?" That's the first line and also the title of the sonnet, which is a regular thing that occurs. If you look at these syllables closely and count them, and you learned this probably by clapping in primary school, you'll notice that there are 10 syllables in the sentence. An iamb is a type of metrical foot in poetry, and an iambic foot consists of two syllables, the first unstressed and the second stressed. So if I were to read out this sentence with only the word da-dum, you would hear da-dum, 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 da-dum. As you can see in the first line of Sonnet 18, there are five iambs. So one unstressed stressed syllable is one iamb, and then there are five of those, 5 feet. Now from the ancient Greek comes the word penta, which means five. So the combination of the iamb and the amount of feet, we get 2 times 5, which is called an iambic pentameter. You could also have this structure with only 8 syllables or 6, etc., and then they would have different names. But for now, we will only focus on this structure, as blank verse is usually written with iambic pentameter. Note that the stressed syllables, even at the end of a sentence, don't necessarily rhyme in blank verse. This could accidentally happen, or intentionally maybe, but it should be kept to a minimum. Otherwise, your piece will not be a blank verse. Blank verse has no fixed number of lines. Whenever you are finished, you are finished. There are some variations on blank verse, but we'll not get into those right now. For the weekly assignment, just consider your blank verse as your free verse on steroids, so you can really show off all of your poetic skills with this one. But in order to do so, however, you must get yourself familiarized with some important poetic devices. Also, if you still find blank verse to be very difficult, don't worry. We are definitely going to spend some time on this during the online class. Now, let's get technical. There is a great number of poetic devices that you could use when creating poetry. The list on this page is what we'll start with, and if you find your interest in poetry to have sparked after class, you should really look into all of the other possibilities to further improve your work. But for now, let's get you started with the basics. You might want to take notes on this part, as the online class will refer to these devices, and your teacher will expect you to understand what they're talking about. Feel free to use a cheat sheet during class, but have them at your disposal so we don't waste too much time on terminology. Alliteration is derived from Latin's littera. It means letters of alphabet. It's a stylistic device in which a number of words, having the same first consonant sound, occur close together in the series. The example sentence is alliterative here because the same first letter of words, B or S sound, B, occur close together and produce alliteration in the sentence. But a better butter makes a batter better. An important point to remember here is that alliteration does not depend on letters but on the sounds. So the phrase not naughty is alliterative, but cigarette chase is not. In our daily life, we notice alliteration in the names of different companies. It makes the name of a company catchy and easy to memorize. So we have Dunkin' Donuts, Coca-Cola, PayPal, and I'm sure you can think of many more. Even in names, it's quite normal to have alliteration. Ronald Reagan. So the creators of Superman, Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster, have taken alliteration in character names to an extreme, as most of the characters in Superman have the initials LL, Lex Luthor, Lana Lang, Lois Lane, Linda Lee. And if you Google this, you will find about 50 more. Just a fun fact for you right there. Assonance takes place when two or more words close to one another repeat the same vowel sound, but start with different consonant sounds. The same vowel sounds of the short vowel E repeats itself in almost all the words, excluding the definite article. Men sell the wedding bells. The words do share the same vowel sound, but start with different consonant sounds. So unlike alliteration, which involves repetition of the same consonant sounds. Now, imagery means to use figurative language to represent objects, action, and ideas in such a way that it appeals to our physical senses. Usually, it is thought that imagery makes use of particular words that create visual representation of ideas in our minds. The word imagery is associated with mental pictures. However, this idea is but partially correct. Imagery, to be realistic, turns out to be more complex than just a picture. Imagery needs the aid of figures of speech like simile, metaphor, personification, and onomatopoeia in order to appeal to the bodily senses. The sound of a drum in the distance attracted him. Now, a simile is a figure of speech that makes a comparison, showing similarities between two different things with the help of the words like or as. Therefore, it is a direct comparison. John is as slow as a snail. Snails are notorious for their slow pace, and here the slowness of John is compared to that of a snail. The use of as in the example helps to draw the resemblance. Now, a metaphor is a figure of speech that makes an implicit, implied, or hidden comparison between two things that are unrelated but which share some common characteristics. In other words, a resemblance of two contradictory or different objects is made based on a single or some common characteristics. Now, to put it in simple English, when you portray a person, a place, a thing, or an action as being something else, even though it's not something else, you are speaking metaphorically. Now, if you look at the example here, laughter is the best medicine. Of course, laughter is not a real medicine in such a way that it is not prescribed by doctors. It does show similar results, as it brings joy, it shows signs of healing. But what is important to note is that a metaphor is different from a simile, because we do not use like or as to develop a comparison in metaphor poems and metaphor sentences. A metaphor makes an implicit or hidden comparison, and not an explicit one like a simile. Onomatopoeia is defined as a word which imitates the natural sounds of things. It creates a sound effect that mimics the thing described, making the description more expressive and interesting. For instance, saying, "The gushing stream flows in the forest," is more meaningful description than just saying, "The stream flows in the forest." The reader is drawn to hear the sound of a gushing stream, which makes the expression more effective. But also think of sounds animals make, like meow or moo, or words like ding-dong when the bell chimes. Now, personification is a figure of speech in which a thing, an idea, or an animal is given human attributes. The non-human objects are portrayed in such a way that we feel they have the ability to act like human beings. For example, when we say, "The sky weeps," we are giving the sky the ability to cry, which is normally a human quality. So we can say that the sky has been personified in this example. Repetition is a literary device that repeats the same words or phrases a few times to make an idea clearer and more memorable. There are several types of repetition commonly used in both prose and poetry. And as a rhetorical device, it could be a word, a phrase, or a full sentence, or a poetical line repeated to emphasize its significance in the entire text. Repetition is not distinguished solely as a figure of speech, but more as a rhetorical device. And there are many types of repetition, even like the Rihanna song, "Work, work, 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 work." It does stick, doesn't it? But let's look at the example here. If you think you can do it, you can do it. So you can use repetition on chunks of text as well. Oxymoron is a figure of speech in which two opposite ideas are joined to create an effect. The common oxymoron phrase is a combination of an adjective preceded by a noun with contrasting meanings, such as cruel kindness or living death. However, the contrasting words or phrases are not always glued together. The contrasting ideas may be spaced out in a sentence, such as the example here. In order to lead, you must walk behind. Now, we've already talked about rhythm a little when we discussed the meter. Rhythm refers to the overall tempo or pace at which the poem unfolds, while meter refers to the measured beat established by patterns of stressed and unstressed syllables. Poets who write free verse generally de-emphasize or ignore meter and focus instead on refining and tuning their natural speech rhythms to suit the poem's tone and content. Rhyme is a popular literary device in which the repetition of the same or similar sounds occur in two or more words, usually at the end of lines in poems or songs. In a rhyme in English, the vowel sounds in the stressed syllables are matching, while the preceding consonant sounds do not match. If you look at the two examples here, you can see that there are different possibilities with rhyme schemes. So the first one is AABB, which means there are four lines, and then the first two rhyme together, which are called A and A, and then the last two sentences also rhyme together, and that's rhyme word B and B. So hello darkness, my old friend, I've come to talk to you again. So that's AA, and then because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping. So that's BB. And then if you look at the second one, that's ABCB. So the first and the third line do not rhyme, but the second and the fourth one do. What I gotta do to make you want me? What do I gotta do to make you care? What do I do when lightning strikes me, so me and me, and I wake to find that you're not there? You could technically say that maybe me and me don't rhyme together, but it works both as repetition and rhyme. So you can try different forms to see what works for your ideas. You can also read some poetry like you like to analyze what the writers have done there. On the topic of analyzing poetry, you need to understand the theories we've just discussed, the poetic devices we've discussed, so you can interpret what the writer is trying to say. Now, for now, all you need to know is that when analyzing poetry, you need to look at three different kinds of meaning: the literal, the figurative, and the personal. The literal meaning is what the poem exactly means when you only look at the words and their dictionary definitions, basically. The figurative meaning is what the poem says beyond the words, so I actually look at the devices we talked about that the author chose to use. And finally, there's a personal meaning, and that's the reader's response. And this might be different for each reader. Think of some people who cry with certain songs because it reminds them of someone or something, and other people might not feel the same with that song. Now we're going to apply this table to analyze some poems in the online class, so make sure you've also studied these concepts as well as the devices for the figurative meaning. Some final notes before we end this lecture. It is important to study the poetic devices. They will help you with all kinds of writing, and they will also help improve your language skills in general. Bring your newfound knowledge to classes so that you can show your skills and get feedback on it. Participation is key, and the more you participate, the better your chances of passing the course, because, well, you will get a lot more feedback than just keeping your microphone on mute.
We have reached the end of this lecture, and questions can be asked in class.